We are 20 kilometers from Denkanal town, beside this canal that runs down from the Rengali Dam. The hills in the distance are the catchment from where rainwater drains down to this area. 25 years in the making, the canal is still far from providing water to the fields in this rain shadow region. Instead, it stands as a concrete barrier that actually blocks the ingress of water from the catchment area, thus adding to the troubles of the farmers here. We shall take a look at the measures taken in one farm in the area to address this problem of scarcity of water. This is Goilo. Attached to this homestead are some 200 acres of agro land, all held as a joint property for the last seven generations by the family of the Misras. After independence, the family moved to urban areas and achieved eminence in every field. But in the process, the village and its farmland fell into neglect. 4 years ago, Moina turned his attention to this neglected ancestral property. Through many trials and as many failures, he discovered for himself the problems of farming without sufficient water. He brought in experts from irrigation and agriculture, and they noticed that the land showed remnants of ponds, barricades, and channels. These were the remains of a water management system created and maintained by the ancestors. These early cultivators were entirely dependent on rainwater and used traditional systems to conserve it so that they had water for Rabi and Kharif, that is to say, for the monsoon and for the winter crop. 50 years of neglect had left the system dysfunctional, and groundwater levels had fallen very low. The new team put in place a systematic project for water harvesting. They began by reviving two large intake ponds, the first collection points for rainwater.
This is one of the two major intake ponds. The water first comes from the catchment area and it is stored here. So you can see 3/4 of this big pond has dikes and 1/4 is open. That's the quarter where the rain water comes into the pond. And on both sides of the arm, there are two channels which will take the water into the field. The entire 200 acres of this paddy field area is divided into three levels, upland, midland and lowland. So the water first comes into the upland area where it is as far as practicable stored or barricaded, then released into midland and finally into the lowland. The idea is to have water on surface for as long as possible so that it sits down underground. We are now walking on this bund. This is on the midland level. There is another pond on the upland level which we'll walk down. And I'll show you there. Now we are right on the top of the divide between the upland and the midland. And the shrubs you see around this, that's where it is elevated to store water in the upland area. The water from upland doesn't easily move down to the midland. And that is how it is conserved in the upland area. You see the dike from that corner, that flowery shrub, running right into this canal over here. That's the first water collection pond, across and above it. We are right now almost at the highest level of our paddy land. Now you see the pond where first rain water is collected and it is stored. And this pond is connected to the main collection source.
Which is? Where?
Which is across. It's difficult to access there. So you can start from here. And from here it goes to the mainland down. Previously what used to happen, this water used to run down fast and quick. Now it takes much longer time to travel the distance, whereby the water seeps into the underground and the subsoil water level increased gradually. Water from the pond, which we saw in the first place, this is the seepage, which means that water table is really high. Normally, during these periods, it would be very hard to find some water in the place. This is an old water source which we rediscovered. It had fallen into disuse. We reclaimed it. This is a deep source, maybe 15 feet. The water is perennial here.
Limbo asuna eti basuna. Kimti tamaro eti kon kamo korucho kon hochi pani bisere kon ko.
Pani to agenti shotkodia hochi au.
Pani osuvidha hochi na pani bhalo hochi.
Nain pani osuvidha hochi. Pani mukti to houni barsha hale pani houni au upuru jaha amar pani hale amar bebshana jauchi. Pani kon bandhuru tike na pani thala heira tike tike korigi sukila khali ruilu au. Sukila sudu ruil. Pore jani ki ye dhano hai. Ye jo utte asura hai. Pani hela asuda. Tankar hela kono tankar bandha pukuri nahi.
So if those people are complaining that they didn't get rice, how come you have so much rice here?
See the difference of. Because of the delayed rains, they didn't sow the seeds in time. They were waiting for the rains. So we had source of water here to do sowing and wait for transplantation. So even if the rain was delayed, the crop was ready for transplantation in 30-40 days. And by that time, the delayed rain came. When the delayed rain came, everything was normal. So we didn't actually wait for the rainwater for sowing and transplantation. So the effects of rainwater harvesting is felt from here. Mm. We are in the point where the lowland starts and is the end of middleland. Real effect is having a crop in Rabi season.
Oh.
This year we are cultivating on 30 acres of land which will be adequately irrigated. On the left we have wheat. So we have 6 acres of wheat this side. Then ahead of us we are doing about 5 acres of tomato, which I'll show you later. So this is another facilitation for water storage, which is helped by lift irrigation. When we have surplus water on the downstream, and this area can take care of nearly another 15 to 20 acres of winter crop. And now we have the third pond full of water which can be used, for which you have to get down and walk up. So this area is not only in rainside region, also it doesn't have groundwater. We tried before doing the rainwater harvesting, we tried this deep tree well, which goes down to 220 feet, but we couldn't get water, which is why we had to resort to dependence on rainwater harvesting. So this is another, if you can focus on this, this is another failed tree well, but we have retained it to test the water level, subsoil water level. If your cam can have a look inside, you can see the level of water, which is only about 10 to 12 feet down. It was about 20 feet down last winter. You can see the level has increased by about 10 feet this winter. This is what keeps the soil moist and the vegetation green and alive. In 2006, when we came here first, the entire patch was absolutely barren and unused. Now you can see how this entire patch of 15 acres is completely green. There is no patch of idle soil lying anywhere. We are now at the end point of our landmass. What happens is a natural stream which flows into the river. This was not in use for 3-4 years back. What our advisor said that we dig up the whole canal again, so the water accumulates at the last point of the landmass before it flows into the river. That internal canal which we shot earlier, it comes along this tree line, which comes and ends here, right here on this side, and from here the water flows into the river.
At this end of the canal, the advisors recommended a brick wall under the soil, going to a depth of 12 feet and a length of nearly 60 feet. It stands 6 feet above the soil. The idea is to hold in the surface water at the end of the canal. At the same time, the underground barrier prevents the direct egress of water beneath the soil. In order to reach the river, the water is forced to seep deep and wide into the subsoil on this side of the barricade, thus recharging the groundwater. This innovative measure is called a lock-in arrangement. It is really the master key for the regeneration of this land. We have seen how the ponds are full of water this year, enabling a large part of the land to be planted with a winter crop. That is after they gathered this bumper harvest in a year of drought.